everybody.
Thank you for Thank you for having us here.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming, everybody. Jesse Eisenberg.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
So I'm going to launch right into my dozens of questions. So I wanted to ask you, what I read was that this was an Audible drama originally, and that you adapted it for the big screen. How much of the original Audible is this movie? Because I think I read that the first one was about a father.
Yes, exactly. So, and thank you so much for coming and doing this here as well. Yeah, so this started as like a book for Audible, which was three sections. The first section was about a father who's having trouble connecting to his newborn son. It takes place in modern day. And then the second section is from the son's point of view, 15 years in the future. It took place in the year 2032, when I was exploring the kid being a capitalist in 2032, and the only way to make money was to play like online for other countries who would be the audience for his thing. And then the third story was from the mother's perspective, 30 years back in 2003 or 2002, and she's on the campus of Indiana University, and her boyfriend is the love of her life goes to Iraq to fight. And she starts interning at this domestic violence shelter. So it's three perspectives. And so I took that second section, and I loved the mother, I loved the mother as told from the boy's perspective, but it was set in the future, and I don't know how many people here are, and I know you're a very film savvy audience, I don't know if you ever made films, but to set a film in the future and have it be kind of a kitchen sink drama is impossible and stupid. And so I said it in the present day, but it's essentially that story of the boy and the mom and their kind of clash of ideology.
And what made you want to explore this topic of social media, social good, what was it that drove you?
Well, I live in a kind of perpetual state of guilt and shame, and I've been with my wife forever, and my wife is like a social justice advocate. I mean, she teaches, she just started a disability justice program in New York City public school. I'm in the arts, and I'm and oftentimes even like celebrated in the arts, and people see me on the street and everything, but then I come home to somebody who I feel envious of from an ethical perspective. And so I'm constantly feeling like this struggle between doing good in the world and being kind of like famous, and is it possible to kind of do both? And so is it possible that the person who's famous can also be good, and is it possible that the person who's good can also be known, and what is the value of the arts? And so these two characters are representative of this clash in my head. The kid is in the arts, and he's kind of doing something silly. I mean, his songs are kind of juvenile. And the mother, on the other hand, has no respect for it, and she's doing something that has a great immediate benefit. She helps a small group of people in a very substantial and profound way. And he, you could say, entertains thousands of people, but in a kind of surface way. And I'm trying to figure out, like, what is the value of those two things? And what the mother discovers at the end is that the boy's thing does have value, but on its own terms. And yes, he writes these shallow songs, but wait, he's kind of charming, and these people seem to really like it. And what he discovers is, well, my mother built this place, and yes, it serves a limited number of people, and I'm obsessed with only serving tons of people, but you know what? God, she did this thing herself. He sees a picture of her, and she's shoveling, the dirt. And so they're kind of come to accept each other on their own terms.
And I know, I believe that you've written plays. What was it like to write a screenplay, and was it like a very arduous process? Did it take a long time? Can you talk about the process a little bit?
It didn't take that long because I had written this Audible thing, and so the kind of characters were there. It was this wonderful thing where I had written way more than what you see in the movie. And so because I had written their backstories at great length. And my background as a writer is in plays and short stories. And in plays, you get about three or four spoons and one room to tell your story. And then in this, they give you, all the utensils and various rooms. And so I had this amazing luxury. Oh, well, then what if they walk outside here? If you did that in a play, the set designer would shoot you. But here, the movie company tells you, bring a scene outside. Audiences like it when they get to see the trees. And so I felt like I had this kind of amazing luxury,
Did you write the role of Evelyn for Julianne Moore? Because she's perfect. I mean, she's perfect. I know. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I thought of her when I was writing it, but it's the kind of thing, like, you know, you don't allow yourself to think, like, I think Julianne Moore will be in my first movie, you know, you know, and I think Michael Jordan will do Cater. You know, you don't, like, you don't think that because you're stupid. You know, I mean, some people do, but those are the same people for whom it doesn't happen. You know, so, you know, you have to have the kind of humility to think. But I, you know, the thing I excel at is not really like directing or maybe even writing, but like I know how to write for characters because this is like what I have done for 20 years as an actor is like, I'm reading scripts with an eye towards like, is this character doing the same thing in each scene? Like, sorry, is this character consistent? Is the spirit of this person the same from scene to scene? And I know it sounds like an obvious thing, and that should be the case all the time, but so often movie characters shift from scene to scene based on what the movie needs, the system of the movie or the structure or the plot. And so like I knew I could write for what actors like to do. That's like at a bare minimum, I felt I can get good actors. Her, I don't know, but somebody quite talented. And then I was just very lucky, you know.
Yeah. What I also read about it was that you had a hard time, let's say, I think like the first week, giving notes to her and the other actors because you felt uncomfortable, which is surprising because you're an actor.
Yes.
And I'm assuming you get a lot of notes.
I love notes. I love when a director is watching me and saying, you know, I saw what you're doing. I think it's like a little too, you know, whatever, modulated 10%. I love hearing that. I think some actors maybe balk at that kind of thing because they feel it's micromanaging, but I love to be micromanaged. I love to be macromanaged too. Any kind of management, I enjoy. But I had this weird sensation, like I can't tell her. Part of it is because who she is, you know, she's, you know, and she's older than me and she's better than me. And, you know, so all these other things were on my mind as a punishment. And so I felt maybe a little nervous. Yeah, and it was this other thing too, which is like, you know, I could feel that she's feeling me out because I'm the new person on the set in the job that they're doing. In any job, I was the only person doing it for the first time. The person who's painting has painted walls for 50 movies, you know, et cetera. So I kind of felt a little nervous. And then Finn, the young actor, I had just a reverse anxiety. I have different anxieties for each person in my life. But for Finn, I had this feeling of, oh, he's 18 years old. Is this exploitative to give him notes because, you know, he's 18 and he should be enjoying playing soccer, you know, or something. He's Canadian, so, you know, he should be, you know, playing ice hockey or something and not. And so I had this other reverse anxiety, which is maybe I shouldn't be taking advantage of a kid on a set, you know. But both of them are normal, great people, and they both are, you know. And Finn, because he's less well-known to audiences, you know, it's important to say he's just like this brilliant kid. He just directed a movie. He co-directed a movie and co-wrote a movie with the other young actor playing in the movie. Coincidentally, they're best friends, yes. And he's just like a genius, you know, multi-talented person who not only loves movies but now makes movies, so understands the process and is not a kid who is being manipulated by, you know, a director.
He was in your Audible series. Didn't he do the recording?
Yeah, he played himself in the Audible thing, so he kind of was in the show, the project for a long time. He also, in addition to being such a talented actor and now director and everything, he's also like a rock star. Like, he plays online, you get thousands of followers, and plays live shows. So it was like just no one else could play the part for like 1,000 logistical reasons as well as skill, you know.
So I love him. Just a question about the last scene when he's little. Did you just have that video? Because it's perfect. He says, I'm vlogging for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
How did that come about?
I don't know if you saw, about like 4 years ago, these Belgian brothers made a video of Tom Cruise, and he's putting on a hat, and he says, hey, I'm Tom Cruise, and he's talking about, and it's not him. It was called a deep fake. And so it's these Belgian brothers who are, you know, computer geniuses and very artful guys. And they started this company to make deepfakes, which is a dangerous tool potentially, but, you know, for art purposes, creative. And so they do they do essentially like work for governments to, you know, figure in, they're in Belgium, you know, so, you know, they do work for like European governments there, you know, to test out what videos are fake because they're experts in this. And so we were wondering what to do for the ending, and Finn, the actor, I said, do you have any videos of you as a kid talking? Maybe we could see you as a kid. And he sent me this like 7-minute video It's what you see in the movie, but we then deepfaked it. So we gave these Belgian brothers this deepfake. I recorded the dialogue I want. They downloaded his video into their machine, and they spent about a week on it. I recorded the dialogue I wanted. So I said, hi, I'm Ziggy Katz, and I'm going to be doing my thing. And we gave it to them. They did it with my voice. And then we held auditions for a sound-alike for Finn as a young boy. So we gave these young actors, voiceover actors, a clip of him at that age, at 10 years old or whatever, and said, can you guys come in and replicate that voice? So then they replaced my voice, which was on his 10-year-old mouth, and you saw the kind of dangerous, you know, foreboding HAL 2001 A Space Odyssey version of our finale.
That's amazing. Wow.
Yeah.
I literally thought you just got lucky and he, at 10, like, made a video like I want to vlog. Wow.
No. Actually, sorry, that line is his. When he said, I'm going to vlog for the first time and we'll see how it goes, that line is his. When he says, this is the real Ziggy Katz, thanks for tuning in, that's not real. No, some of the lines are real. So that's the other thing, is like threading, seeing what we could find. It was a fascinating process. It wasn't my idea. it was like one of the producers, Dave McCary, who directed at SNL for like 10 years. And so he's very interested in like, so he would do the SNL shorts for years. And so he just became very good at figuring out, so he's one of the producers, and he became very good at figuring out what technology can be used in very efficient ways to make kind of crazy things. You know, so he thinks outside the box in a way that I don't. For me, the lines at the end where he has this monologue that kind of harkens back to something he says earlier, and we just felt, oh, it didn't feel like it was working. So Dave thinks outside the box. That's one of the wonderful things about collaborating with people who have a kind of technical expertise that wouldn't even occur to somebody like me.
Well, let me ask you about directing. First of all, have you always wanted to direct? I mean, like you said, you spent 20 years acting and you're still acting. Was it always the dream to direct?
No, but I think maybe not, because maybe I wouldn't allow my conscious mind to think that I want to do something that everybody says they want to do, which I just, as like a person who like rejected the Knicks when I was younger, for the same reason, you know, everybody says they want to do it, I don't like that or something. So, and then I was writing my plays and I felt good about that, and that was kind of like my outlet. And when I say outlet, I just am referring to like what actors need to do to stay sane, because even the most successful actors will have, you know, 8 months at a year, 6 months at a year sometimes off, and you can go just crazy and you have to do something else. And some people of course have like charities and wonderful social work. Some people drink because they can't handle that kind of thing. My wife does charity and I can't hold alcohol. So for me, I would write plays, and that was kind of like my outlet. And then when I started thinking about this story, I was like, thought about, oh, wouldn't it be a nice idea for a movie to see these two things, to see this online world and to see a shelter, something I know about through connection, a family connection, and wouldn't that be interesting to see? And so when I finished the script, I thought I should direct it. And you know, I'm gonna be 40 next year, and so like, you know, it's the kind of thing, like if I'm gonna do something like that, then I should start now, you know, as opposed to when I started acting and I was 18 and I was not Finn Wolfhard with the confidence and talent of a thousand sons, and you know, because he directed his first movie at 18, you know. But so I thought, okay, if I'm gonna do this thing, maybe I should start now, even though it kind of makes me nervous, and you know, that's what came out.
I have to ask, I mean, because you've worked with some of the most incredible directors throughout your career. One of my favorites is David Fincher and Noah Baumbach, all these amazing directors. Did you reach out to any of them about directing, or did you, like, take anything that they did on set that you've, you know, like, did they influence you?
I didn't, like, explicitly ask, but you kind of, like, pick up things when you're there. I mean, you know, David Fincher works in the most unusual way, unlike any other director working today or possibly ever. The way he directs is, he does, I mean, he's a genius in a way that I've never seen before, even not in movies, you know, but he'll do like 100 takes of the same thing, you know, a close-up of the glass being picked up, he'll do like 100 takes of it. And so he's working in a kind of film system that doesn't exist outside of his own world. And so there's really nothing to take away, because you just need to have an attention span to do that as a director and a budget to do that. And so there's just no, but I've worked on so many wonderful things where I saw people create tones and sensibilities on set that made me feel really nice as an actor, and I was trying to replicate that. I remember being on a set of a movie when I was like in 2010 or 9 with this director, Greg Mottola. He had done Superbad, and then we were on this movie, Adventureland. And he's such a wonderful guy. And I had like a panic attack on set in one of the scenes, and I said, I'm so sorry, I don't know what happened to me. I think I had a panic during that scene. I think I screwed it up. And he said, that's okay, you're doing a very vulnerable job. That's normal. If you didn't have that, I would be surprised. And it stuck with me as like, oh, here's a guy who's trying to make his movie and to try to get his days and to try to make his comedy and and all the things he's trying to do, and had the sensitivity to understand that, oh, my job is unusual. And so I took that kind of rang true in my head more than almost anything else of how can I be sensitive to everybody on set, a production designer who feels like her work is not being valued or treated appropriately or shot in the way that makes it a pop or whatever. That's the kind of stuff that I took away more than like the technical stuff. And the other thing is, it's like, this is my story. I know it so well. It's not like I'm coming into somebody else's script. So it's more about like, how can I accomplish this thing that I think about all the time, rather than like taking something. And then just in terms of like osmosis, you have a sense of like, oh, when the camera could move in this way here, it'd be much better, just because I've been on sets.
I will open it up to questions from the audience really soon. I just wanted to ask about, now, Emma Stone produced this with her husband.
Yeah.
I'm blanking.
No, his name is Dave McCary. He's the guy I was telling you about. He worked on Saturday Night Live for a while.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. And how does that work? Did they just give their names, or did they actually come to set? And, how did it work?
Yeah, so I had three producers, and when I say three producers, I mean in every meeting with every editor interview, with every production designer interview, and that was Emma and Dave and their partner, Ali Herding. And they were the people who we interviewed every composer and editor and art director and assistant director and unit production manager. This was during the pandemic, so we were on Zoom every day doing these interviews. And it was their first movie as producers, and it was my first movie. And so they were very, very involved. I mean, as involved as a producer can get, and probably even more involved than most producers, because it was their first thing, and we were all kind of excited to be doing this new thing. And so, they were very involved. Their name, I mean, Emma's especially, obviously, is helpful in terms of like getting meetings with certain people and making calls that the rest of us couldn't make. But the main help she had was in her taste, her judgment, and support in the way a normal producer would work.
Well, that is great to hear. I am going to open it up to questions. So, does anyone have one? No.
I think we've answered everything. Yeah. through. Oh, sorry. Yeah, thanks a lot.
It was a wonderful, wonderful film.
Thank you.
I was particularly struck by your use of the music. The way the music was chosen at different moments, it seemed as if the music had a different job to do in each scene. Sometimes it would contrast the absurdity of the scene.
Yeah.
At other times it would make you more anxious watching the scene. At other times it was like almost mocking the scene. I was just wondering if you could address how you used music and how that sort of worked in using different kinds of music to evoke a lot of different feelings.
Oh, you're so kind, and that's so astute. Yeah, that's exactly how we thought about it. So the composer of the movie, who doesn't have like as much music as we hoped in the final product, but this is like his fourth movie, the last one he was nominated for an Oscar for, which was Minari. He's like a young genius. So he started composing stuff. The only kind of note I gave him was like, try composing something that would be written by the character, which is to say with homemade Casio keyboards. So all that kind of ner-ner-ner-ner stuff you're hearing is actually from an old Casio. So it would be the kind of thing that the kid would have created. And I said, see if that can like kind of almost dovetail into score. And then so that became kind of like the, let's say, rubric for how we're gonna make the score. And then for the mother, it was like, she's straddling these two worlds, because she's very sophisticated personally, very highbrow taste, and so she's constantly listening to classical music, which of course is like, which is a slap in the face to the kid who's playing stuff that she's not interested in, but she loves music and she's constantly surrounded by music. It's just never his music, and so we thought it it sums her up quite well, the taste that she has. She has very highbrow taste, and yet she works in a profession where she's actually on the ground. She's not, you know, an armchair philosopher. She's actually in the field, so to speak. And so we contrasted those two things, so the kids' music and her music. And I only wish I had more of Emile's music, which is the score, but we started falling in love, me and the editor, with the classical music and what that did to teach us as an audience who this woman is.
Yeah. I'm not exactly sure what my question is, but I wanted to say that I just this week finished watching Fleischman is in Trouble.
Oh, yeah. Oh, thanks a lot.
And I loved it.
Thanks.
And I noticed a lot of similarities between that and this in the conflict between people in the same family, between people with different ideas about money and making money, and I just wanted to say that and ask you about it.
No, it's funny you should say that, and the first thing that pops into my head is, well, first of all, and thank you so much for saying that, but the first thing that pops into my head is, like, the writer of that show, Taffy, and I both saw the play Leopold Stott, which I'm sure probably a lot of people have seen, like, a week apart, and she was like, I've been having that conversation they had on stage, my Olive, and I was like, I've been having that conversation, you know, how assimilated are we, that kind of conversation, and so when you said that, it just occurred to me that, oh yeah, this is just the thing that Jewish people talk about all the time, you know, and how the similarities are probably derived from, like, you know, my parents are teachers, my mom teaches doctors how to be sensitive to patients, and my dad teaches people who are already in the healthcare industry how to have a more, like, mastery over the business aspect of healthcare, and they're great people, and then I come home and I'm like, you know, on a show and I'm having sex on a TV show, and so, like, you know, so we have the same debates, and my parents are so proud of me, and of course, and are very, you know, loving and supportive of my stuff, but, you know, but it's the same debates that everybody has, you know, and then you think, like, you know, in Jewish families, I mean, I don't want to say it's exclusive to Jews, because of course it's not, but where you're, you know, trained to kind of question everything, and then also, you find Jews in the arts in such a distinct way, but also in professions like social service, you know, and so, like, you know, our debates are probably, you know, happening a lot. And forgive me for saying it's exclusive, because it's not. It's not exclusive to Jews, but it's just something that I've noticed my Jewish friends and I having debates about.
There was a question over here.
So you've been acting, you said, for like 20 years?
Yeah.
And I assume you've been writing almost as long, and now you've started directing. Understanding that you're not going to want to pigeonhole yourself. Yeah. If you could only do one thing for the rest of your career,
yeah,
what would you want to do and why?
I wanted to play for the Suns. I'm doing all of this because I'm short. I don't know. You're not seeing the full breadth of my desire and pleasure. You're seeing the thing I've been relegated to. I don't know. I'm doing a movie in April where I'm acting and directing and writing it, and it's in Poland, and it's about two cousins who go on, like, a Holocaust tour. So that is probably, like, you know, the like, you know, the dark matter of all my interests, including the Polish history, and writing, directing, acting. You know, I just like staying busy. I just notice in the arts, like, if you're not staying busy, I just go crazy. I really do. I mean, if I have nothing to do in the day, I feel so anxious, and so I like to stay busy. And what I've noticed is, like, actors, I think, often feel a sense of, like, powerlessness. You know, you're judged for the most, you're judged, you know, the thing you were self-conscious of in high school, how your nose looks, you know, your weird knees, is the thing that then the New York Times writes about when you're an adult, you know what I mean? Well, with his eye, you know, with his chin, you know, entering first, you know, and so it's like, you have to do something else to, like, empower yourself in the arts to not feel like you're at the mercy of things you totally can't control, you know, and so for me, that's what doing all this stuff is, and not because, like, I'm doing this just for a sense of empowerment, but just to, like, stay busy and feel like the arts are something that is not governing me, but that I'm kind of governing it too, you know. Oh, sorry. And then we could go right after. She's been shunned at every moment. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, maybe we should go first. No, because right at the beginning, and then. Okay, and then we'll go right there because you're being so generous. So.
My questions are much more lowbrow, but I was interested that the smart car played a really big role, and.
Yeah.
And it was the absence of the cell phone, which I thought was really odd for that age group in high school. Like, I didn't see anybody with a phone.
Yeah.
My daughter's a high school teacher, and that's all she talks about is the involvement that the kids have with their phones.
Yeah.
That's question number one. Question number two was the father reading about the teenage suicide a red herring? Because I kept thinking, oh my God, something really bad is going to happen. When it was really beautiful at the end, so.
Oh, you're funny to say that because somebody else told me that. They're like, he's going to kill himself. They were reading the script, and I was like, what? No, what are you even, how are you even? And I didn't realize up until this exact moment that that's why they thought that. Yeah, so, but the movie's locked. And so, yeah, that didn't occur to me. My friend said at the end, I thought he was going to kill himself. What's that? Sorry about that. So, okay, so two people. Well, hindsight. And in terms of the cell phones, I hate seeing cell phones in movies. I hate it so much. I just, from an aesthetic perspective, I can't stand it. I hate as an actor holding the phone. It just is like it totally deadens anything that's happening dramatically, you know, because they're looking at something and you could either dramatize it by having a little screen where you see it, but then it feels like a super modern thing, which is on the show I'm on has a lot of that, but it's part of the plot in such an integral way, you can't not do that. But in something like this, which is supposed to kind of feel like kind of a homemade art house kind of movie, it's just, there's something like deadening about that. I wanted to do all the technology in kind of a homemade kind of way. We had these amazing people design this website that the kid is on. It's completely like bespoke website. All of the people on the website are like, most of them are my wife's students. And I asked them, please make like a 3-minute video of yourself watching them. And then we had them do retakes because they weren't excited enough or they were, you know, too. And so like everything is like, you know, made. And the idea was like, this is going to look like lo-fi, you know, as much as we can, you know, because it's the style of the movie. We shot on 16mm film. It should feel like this kind of handmade thing. And I just can't stand the cell phone thing. It just like, I think immediately alienates the audience. And I feel like, okay, I didn't feel like I was missing it. I didn't feel like, oh, this scene, he would only be on his cell phone, he's done. Actually, no, that's not true. There's one scene in the scene you mentioned where the dad is talking to him. The scene opened with the kid at dinner, like reading below the table, and he was on a website for poverty, because you know he's trying to like teach himself, and he was on Wikipedia. We made a Wikipedia page of poverty because he's trying to like better himself, but he doesn't have the wherewithal to think of something more sophisticated to Google, and then we just cut it out because it looked weird, and then the smart car thing partly comes from a real thing, but also just the idea that here's a mother who drives a kid to school every day who's a guitar player, and the guitar doesn't even fit in the car, you know? It's like, and she's, you know, an activist and, you know, obviously would be an environmentalist and, you know, that non-polluting car, but just the comedy of just, you know, I have a son and he plays the cello and I got a bicycle, you know, that kind of thing. And thank you so much. Yeah. Oh, thank you, and thank you for waiting.
Of course. I wanted to say that the mother-son relationship was really interesting for me to watch, as I'm sure it was for any mother with a son. And you said because of the Audible, you were able to access the backstory of the characters. So I'm really interested in the mother's character. She's a very particular kind of person.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about her background?
Yes, yes, yes. I think she's somebody who has, in some ways, like, she has such a dogmatic sense of ethics that she has grown to feel unsympathetic towards her child. The irony, of course, is that because she's so brilliant and because she's married to a brilliant guy and she's created a middle or upper middle class child, and it's the exact thing she resents about the world. She resents upper middle class people. She thinks they should be taxed at 90% of their income. Because she serves people who are being paid for by social services, you know, because they're serving people who are being supported by, you know, social services. And so she's resented the thing she created and then resents in her, she's to blame for that. And so she's developed this kind of, she can't reconcile this thing in her head of who she's created. It's the thing she resents, but it's also her fault for doing it. And so she sees in this other boy a chance in some ways unconsciously to be the parent to the kid, or at least feels a closeness to this kid that is the thing she would more likely want to parent. And so that's where that came from. I think about her a lot in the book. The backstory is her boyfriend was killed overseas, and she had turned her into this kind of more, you know, philosophically dogmatic individual. When you see her here, it's like the kind of person you can recognize who, you know, who lives out her values to such a degree that maybe it turns her off to certain people who are well-meaning but not in line with her values. You know, and I see that a lot because I'm in that milieu a bit. And I always find those people so fascinating because I'm in an industry where where public people constantly profess their values because they go to a benefit once a year and take pictures. And it's so fascinating to me to see people who really live out their values, you know.
So we have time for one more question.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention, I saw you about 21 years ago in the same type of situation.
Is it David Edelstein?
At Roger Dodger.
Yes, with David Edelstein from New York Magazine, yes.
In Manhattan, it was a sneak preview
with
I think Brown, Ted Brown.
Oh,
I think
never
his
mind,
name was.
Yes. Yes, of course, he had the film class.
Yes. And it's quite a difference to see you back then as a young man whose sister was more famous at the time from her television commercial, and then and then to see you, you know, I've been following your career, just amazed at how spectacular, you know, you've been in all the movies that you've been in. And how is your sister, by the way?
Good. Good, and it feels so triumphant to have surpassed her, as you indicated.
Yes.
No, she's great. Thank you so much. Does he still do those classes?
I have no idea.
Okay, I don't even
know if he's still
we
around.
We both haven't kept up. Okay, yeah. Oh, no, thank you so much. I think I was here for that movie, too. Does anybody know if David Edelstein used to come here? I was, racking my brain trying to think, and I was looking at my email, but it was before email, so I couldn't even I couldn't even have a record of it. Which seems, shocking.
Remember,
sweet to say that. Thank you very much.
Really.
That was so nice. Amazing. That's a great note to end on. And I want to thank Jesse so much
thank you,
for
Addie.
Being here. And thank you all.
Thank you, Addie. Thank you so much for coming here. Thank you so much.